MHCAD came about specifically because a group of faculty at the university from several different departments decided that they wanted an interdisciplinary program. So it wasn't enough for HCI to be a part of the computer science program or an engineering program, but rather it is bringing together great faculty and minds from in the information school, from computer science, from the division of design and kind of like that formal excellence point of view of design. And then in addition to that, with that kind of analytical engineering point of view, right? So the someone I think mentioned, which is like, HCI and design is both left brain and right brain, which is very true, right? It is like, it is deeply analytical and it is also intensely creative. And it tries to create spaces for both of those. And the faculty that came together for this, this is about like even 10 years ago, they started this idea, which was like, we want to offer an interdisciplinary program for our students, especially as they saw the emerging UX practice. So that was like approximately the time I was getting into the business. They were already thinking about like, how are we going to respond to this need that that industry has right now for people that are both analytical and creative. And so one of the things is that the University of Washington in particular was well poised to develop this. It had some of the foremost minds in HCI working on campus, and granted, each different department had its own people that were working on different challenges in HCI. But they, as is typical in a university setting like this, right? Like, I love that term collegiality, which is the sense that all of these people, while they may be part of different organizational units, could come together and work together in order to build something new. We had all of this distributed expertise between James Lenday in computer science and Andy Koh in the information school, Axel Rosler in the division of design, who decided, you know what, like, let's make something together. And so we had all this depth and expertise, and we had this strong desire and passion, and then they said, let's go for it. And they finally put it together 5 years ago. 4 years ago? 4 years ago, Mary, right? 4 years ago. Must be almost five. You would be cohort five. Which is pretty exciting to think. I know you mentioned like our reputation has really like gotten out there in just a few short years. I think our portfolio shows that. And I think that part of it is due to the point of view and perspective that the faculty brought in the generation of this, and frankly, the hard work that Mary and Linda did in the early years of the program. So beyond that, right, we have all of this exceptional things happening in Seattle in particular. And so one of the things that I think that is compelling and interesting about the program itself is that we're situated in a place where there is a confluence of a lot of different industry ideas. High technology, a growing and thriving startup industry, and in addition to like design studios of all different varieties, not only in marketing, but in product and of varying different sizes. So you combine all those things together and MHCAD is the place, and where it came from is that confluence of all of these different events. So I'll talk a little bit more about that in depth and in detail, but one of the things that came from the starting of all this is kind of like, what is our philosophy? Why would you want to come here as opposed to some other places? And so the first tenet is we are very much about creating thoughtful experiences. So we want and insist that all of the projects that we work on are working towards the resolution of real human problems. So it's not enough to basically say like, oh gee whiz, this is cool technology. What we really want to say is like, that's cool technology, but how can we intersect that with things that are meaningful and powerful that actually change people and their behaviors and the way they see the world or the way the world operates? And we do that through the rigorous application of longstanding human-centered design practices and the use of design thinking. So I'm gonna pull out the Tim Brown IDEO card here, but this is basically like the processes and things that those early thinkers started from, we have now, we very much focus on and want to bring to life. The second is we are always interdisciplinary and collaborative, both in teaching and in learning. So one of the things that you'll see in our perspective is that the way we create student groups, and one of the things you should know is that this program is deeply dedicated to working in teams. You will form teams early on, and while they may shift and morph, you need to get comfortable in working and knowing each other for many, many hours at a time. You'll be in close proximity to people, and so with that, we try to form teams that bring people together from different backgrounds and different points of view. So that's the first part in like not only in learning, but we can come together from different backgrounds, right? So many of you have psychology backgrounds or come from research backgrounds or computer science or design, and we try to build teams such that you can draw from each other's experiences. And then the one thing to remember is that we are very iterative as well. So we learn, make, critique, reflect, and refine iteratively. So one of the things that you'll see and one of the things you'll have to learn is learning to bias towards making. There's a lot of issues or problems with overanalyzing a problem, like learning too much about it or trying to step back and saying like, well, what could possibly we do? I would say, go ahead and make 8 things. Do it pretty poorly to start and figure out and find out which ways those things can be successful. But then as part of all of that, like go fast, take chances. We'll also want to bring in industry professionals to help you learn from them and their unique perspectives. So, you know, we're an academic learning environment. We want people to explore and think about new problems and try new things. But at the same time, we don't want you to go out into industry unprepared for some of the realities of doing UX design in industry. And so in order to accomplish that, and especially given that we have 1 year together to do all of this, we try to bring in as many people as possible for touch points in each of our classes through critique, through sponsorship, through the like guest lectures and any possible way that we can bring industry in and get you prepared so that at least you know a little something about what it's like to do UX in the quote real world. And then finally, one of the things that distinguishes us, I think, is that we focus very strongly on creating T-shaped individuals, which is to say you have breadth skills in a number of different areas, but then you also have deep expertise in a number of different areas. And so what we see as breadth skills are things like problem solving, the design and development process and how those things work together, how you learn to solve problems through design and development and their cooperation, how to make decisions collaboratively, which is part of our team-orientedness, right? Which is like, how can you negotiate what you think is the best idea versus someone else? And how can you work to kind of create the best solution based on a number of different opinions and voices? And then finally, being able to actually effectively present and defend your work. This is one of the things, if you're curious about this, like listen to Mike Montero's talk about growing junior designers. It's too bad, how many of you are here through this entire week? He's speaking on Wednesday at Substantial. So if you could find a way to get a ticket, he'll be a hoot, I'm sure. But one of the things that Mike Montero talks about at Mule Design is that, you know, a designer is not anything until they can defend their work and their point of view. And we go very hard on you being able to articulate your design decisions and being able to say, like, this is not only why we think it's the best, but we can prove it. So that's a thing that we focus on as far as the breadth skills. And then we look in depth, especially around our prototyping curriculum is very strong. And we have prototyping as problem solving is one of the core things that we do in the program. Related to prototyping, we also go deep in information architecture, like an area of specialization for me, but a way for us to think about how things are organized, how people think about problems, and how you can manage the construction of their mental models with the problems that you're trying to solve. And then finally, some depth in ethnographic research. One of the things that defines traditional human-centered design is a focus on actually identifying what the problem is before you even begin. And so with that, I believe, and one of the things that I teach regularly is how to do ethnographic research in the service of design challenges. And then finally, videography, because one of the core things that we found time and time again is that being able to talk about your work in short video format is incredibly powerful. And so not only in video prototyping, but also just in storytelling in video form and presenting your work in a way that's encapsulated, we go pretty hard on being able to produce and defend videos of the work that you create. So this kind of works out this way. We have that cross-discipline knowledge and then depth in prototyping, IXD research and videography. So that's what you can kind of expect from any of that. We're gonna talk in depth about what classes we're teaching, but this is the kind of point of view that we take. So there's 4 main components to MHCID. So one of the things about it is, of course, is that you'll be on campus for 1 year, right? You will start in September, You will finish in August, 11 months. During that time, I can tell you that it'll be fairly intense. We do not recommend that you hold a job during this time because there will be so much to do and so many things for you to learn. And it is structured in such a way that you should be dedicating your time and attention to the program full time. But there are four major components. The first is a lecture series of three courses that are mostly focused on establishing the theoretical and historical context of each of the three major areas of HCI. And so we'll talk about what those constitute in just a second, but that's a three credit series per quarter in autumn, winter, and spring, again, that are focused on the theoretical and historical underpinnings. So for some of you who have so Susie, I think you said you did a boot camp, right? They probably don't tell you anything about like where any of this came from. They're just like, here's our practices. We definitely want to say if you go into the studio today, what you'll see is, for instance, a timeline that maps out the history of kind of interactive products from 1900 to modern day. That's a project that students are working on today. That's definitely one of the things that we want you to walk away with, that kind of deep theoretical expertise. We pair the lecture series with a series of studios. And so for those of you who have never engaged in a studio of this manner before, what we'll do is that it's mostly focused on practical, hands-on making. And there are three studios. There are now five studios, which is very exciting. But five studios that allow you to focus on a single design problem and bring to bear a number of different practical methods of exploring that problem space. And each one has its own distinct theme. So I'll show those in a second. Finally, there is a capstone project, which increases in intensity starting in the winter into spring and then finally into summer, manifesting through two studio courses and a short seminar. But basically, this is an opportunity to demonstrate your summative expertise in techniques and problem solving in a team-based environment with industry sponsors. And so this year, our industry sponsors are, let's see if I can list them all off. We have 8 of 9 currently. We have Microsoft, Teague, Frog, Fjord, Seattle Children's Hospital, Intentional Futures. I have two more that I am not calling to mind right now. But it's a really great group. From operating at very high levels as well. So we can get a lot of very prestigious companies that want to come in and work with you and mentor you through the process and usually through like seasoned industry experience. So it's not always a client relationship. Oh, right, sorry, NASA, and there's one more. So we have a good group this year. But it's very exciting to be able to pair your teams with these industry professionals so they can provide their perspective on your process, but you get to work on a project that you define. So one of the characteristics or one of the things that I believe is that you will have plenty of opportunities to work on crummy projects once you get into industry that someone else tells you to work on. This is your chance to define this for yourself. So you get to not only identify what a problem is, work with people to figure out how to best reach them and prototype and design a solution to those problems. I think the capstone process is very exciting. And if you're curious at all to see, all of the projects from previous cohorts are available on the website. I encourage you to watch some of those videos and get a feel for what they're like. And you'll get a chance to see a little bit about what is happening in capstone this year, tomorrow. And then finally, and I think most excitingly, is a weekly seminar put on by the Dub faculty. So Dub is, this interdisciplinary group of faculty that come together once a week. And this is a seminar from visiting scholars, from industry professionals and Dub faculty about research and new topics in design and HCI that are I think it's incredibly valuable and an opportunity for you to meet a lot of different kinds of students across campus. So it's people from all of the different academic departments that have some sort of interest in this field come together, we host lunch, and everybody gets to see a new exciting talk. It also is great fodder for capstone ideas and seeing kind of like what people are working on and what new opportunities exist. So it's very great. I look forward to it every week. It's a nice break, an hour long, like get to see something new and exciting. So the actual curriculum as it works out is like this. So the lecture series starts in fall with a design research course. That's 3 credits that cover the fundamentals of doing and executing what was called user research and usability, but is but broadly constituted as design research. That then follows into the ideation studio, which this year will have the subtitle of Changing Human Behaviors. And so everything that you work on in that particular class will be around the topic of understanding what constitutes human behavior and how can technology be used to shift that in some way or get people to behave in different ways. So changing human behaviors is very exciting, and we've run this before, but it's a new perspective on kind of like how might you bring to bear a number of different techniques in the theme of changing human behaviors. Then, of course, you'll have 1 credit in Dubb's seminar. So 1 credit, you'll write weekly reflections about what you see, but you get to think about the broader context of HCI and what the Dubb faculty are presenting back. And then you also have an elective. So usually between 1 and 5 credits. I think the average is usually about 4 a quarter. But that's from one of our member departments. And that includes courses like Foundations of Interaction Design from the Interaction Design Program. It includes usability testing, the general human-centered design process or overview class from Human-Centered Design and Engineering, and a number of other electives from different departments. So there's a lot of opportunities for you to kind of like slot into areas of exploration. And I can make some recommendations for you. Myself and Matt can help you identify like which electives are the right one based on your objectives or gaps that you may have. So I have a lot of point of view about this. One other thing that we're adding this year, this is new to the program, is a 2-credit immersion studio. So this class I'm very excited about this because this is going back to the original dream, I think, of James Landais, one of the founders of the program. We're going to kick off the cohort a week before fall quarter begins with a 1-week studio. So we'll be in studio Monday to Friday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and beyond, working on a single project with the idea that Monday we get introduced to the problem and by Friday you have a fully, like, you have an operating portfolio piece. It's really exciting to think about like diving in. And while the point of that studio is not necessarily to be like learning core techniques and practices, it's mostly about learning how to give and get critique, learning how to shout down your inner hater, as I like to call it, learning to bias towards making, as I mentioned earlier. And so with the idea that like every day we'll be focusing on like a new phase, and by the end you'll have something to show for it. So that's really exciting. That'll be the kind of the way we kick off the program. Then you get a few days to breathe, and then you start off the quarter on Wednesday. So that's fall quarter. Once fall quarter concludes, you'll get 3 weeks off for Christmas, usually-ish. You come back the first day after New Year's. And then this is a lecture on user interface software and technology. Again, getting down into the core fundamentals of HCI, things like not only like where did the practice come from, what is the history of interfaces in general, but also down into like how do some of the core mechanisms of HCI work? So like fundamental paradigms like WIMP. Anybody heard of WIMP? No? So that's a great topic, right? Windows, icons, menus, pointers, one of the core user interface metaphors. You'll talk about direct manipulation, accessibility. You'll talk about topics including the UI toolkits and, for instance, the way the document object model works. So those core level technology concepts. That will be backed up with a prototyping studio and embodied interactions. And so with that in mind, embodied interactions is also trying to learn and understand something about how physical meets digital. So we'll be working on a concrete topic that is about not just kind of software interfaces, but interfaces that kind of manifest in the real world. And that can take a number of different topics, including UbiComp. It may take the form of wearables or like direct devices or really kind of screenless interfaces as well. So that would be the second studio, embodied interactions. That's backed up again with another 1-credit Dubb seminar. and then your first course in capstone planning. Capstone planning will be all about identifying a team, defining a topic area that you're interested in pursuing, and starting to think about how you might craft a problem statement around your capstone project. So that's starting very early. Like, you're going to come in like the first few months, you'll be starting to think about what is the project that will be the summative representation of your learning. And then on top of that, you can take between usually around 1 to 3 credits and electives. Again, it's somewhere between 3 and 4 that many students take. Kind of depends on availability. So winter concludes, you get a week off for spring break, just 1 week. You come back, and in the spring, you start with design of interactive systems. That, again, is covering the history of kind of design of different systems, starting from basically like Bauhaus through modern day, but also covering different modes and paradigms of design thinking. So this is taught by Axel Rosler. He'll begin kind of talking about the context of socio-technical design, but also from a number of different points of view, like what is the difference between functional design and scenario-based design? How do those things come about? And how do you compare and contrast them? With the idea that by the time you finish this lecture series, you have an understanding of the core underpinnings of our discipline to the point where you should be able to understand, like, why do we do certain things, and how can you mix and match those different techniques and methods into a coherent process that you can define for yourself, right? This is one of the things that makes exceptional practitioners across the board, is people that know what the toolkit is to their that is available to them, and how you can bring those to bear in individual situations, because as we all know, the great irony of design is everything is it depends. Ask designer about that, you know, like, we'd like, what do you do? Well, it's like, well, it depends. What we want you to do is to be able to walk away with an answer to that question, right? It depends, but I would start with, and that's what the lecture series will help you provide. We also then start in with Research Studio, which is all about design challenges and responses. And so you'll get your opportunity to engage in formative user research around your capstone topic with the idea that you can fully define and understand what is the problem that you're trying to solve, in the sense of kind of like, what makes a good design problem? How do you differentiate, for instance, between a design problem and a policy problem? Which is an increasing, like, these things are colliding more and more, where we believe that we can solve some sort of policy problem with a technology solution, but those are solving problems in a lot of ways, or causing problems in a lot of ways. And so with the idea that by the end of that, you will emerge with a set of design concepts of which you can down select one for your Capstone Studio. And then we reinforce that with, again, another quarter of Dubb Seminar and a portfolio seminar. So you can take one credit that will show you all about how to construct a meaningful UX portfolio and also begin your job search. And then also, if you so desire, you can take an elective in this quarter. By this time, you should, even with Capstone Studio in mind, you should be getting close to your number of credits. So oftentimes people do not take an elective in the spring in order to think about constructing your own portfolio, working on a side project or refining things that you may have worked on earlier in the program. And then finally, Capstone Studio is in the summer. That meets twice a week. This is all about hands-on work on your capstone project, with the idea that by the end of this, you are ready to present your project and demonstrate your expertise in HCI. So this is basically just showing a little bit about where Capstone comes in. You can see you put a lot of credits, 14 credits, into the Capstone process. It is what creates really robust, interesting, and defendable projects. And I think what makes our portfolio and MHCID especially compelling is the amount of time that we put into this. Capstone is a heck of a lot of fun. So these are some examples from Prototyping Studio. This is Brandon in the current cohort, Brian in the current cohort, working on an Arduino problem. So they're breadboard and wiring. So we get into physical computing. This is from 2 cohorts ago. We have a typical exercise about, you know, kind of prototyping and understanding, like, the like shower environment. How can you do all of these things? And here's a cardboard paper prototype that was made. This is Emily and Maggie with a soldering iron working on in the makerspace, working on their prototyping studio project. It's really exciting to be involved in these processes, and our studios are really interesting and fun. Because they're about pragmatic problem solving, it's not 5 hours of lecture and talking. Usually it's about 40 minutes of introducing you to a problem. You get a lot of hands-on opportunity to practice a particular method or technique. And then we dedicate a significant portion of class time to feedback. So one of the things that I am most interested in, one of the things that defines me as a designer, is my seeking and wanting to provide critique and feedback. It's not merely enough to be able to try and practice and iterate yourself. You need external opportunities to have someone say, like, this is working, continue doing this. This isn't working, you should stop doing this. Or have you considered these alternatives? And that's a big part of our studio process and practice is, we want people consistently making things, pinning them up, getting feedback, having people point out ways that they can be improved or not. And that's a big part of what the design process is. And we lean very heavily on getting peer feedback, but also bringing in outsiders to help provide critique as well. So we try to bring in industry people into our studios to provide their point of view on the work that you're creating. So that's a big part of our studio process and one of the things I think that distinguishes MHCID from our competitor programs. One other thing too is that we are at this confluence of all four different areas. So we've talked about this before, but another thing that makes us particularly unique is this intersection of the city of Seattle, our program, MHCID in particular, but also the support of Dub and the support of the University of Washington. And it's all of these things together, right? The University of Washington is one of the kind of world's leading public universities. It's one of the largest research universities that's still like a public university. We have tons of resources available to us and a lot of different points of view and perspectives. And so broad partnerships, even look at here in Startup Hall. This is part of Commotion, the university startup incubator. And they're all about taking the intellectual property that's generated on campus and all of the great thinking and helping people launch new companies directly on campus. And so you can see, if you look out through these windows, there's all these different pods of different startup teams. As you walk out, there's a bunch of sheets of paper right on the wall out here, right to your right, that show a lot of the projects that people have been working on in the technology area here. And it's really exciting to be a part of all of this and why I think MHCID is particularly interesting. So here's a photograph of our current studio and a bunch of students working away. And then the Dub Seminar. Our Dub Seminar has grown much larger than this. We're in one of the biggest rooms on campus now. So we're in Kane Hall, the big lecture hall. If you were to go to a 400-person undergraduate class, that's in Kane Hall. That's where we're at these days. And lots of great contributions and ways of thinking. And then we are supported by all four of these programs. And so the Allen School, the Information School, HCDE, and the Division of Design are the things that kind of give us our faculty and our approach. And so besides me, there are two people from each of the departments that make up our faculty team. So you get a chance to meet some of them today at lunch, but we're also supported by professional and continuing education. I only point this out because you'll be dealing a lot with PCE. What's in UWC squared now? They just rebranded, so it's could be a little confusing, but that's a part of kind of like how we're made up, right? So this is not like one tiny little wedge of the university, but we are supported university-wide. And that's, we'll be heading there in just a few minutes. This is the quad. This is the center of campus. Seattle is also one of the great reasons why you would come here, just even beyond the four technology companies. Apple also doesn't fit in here, but they have an office here. I've never met anybody who's worked there yet, but Google is continuously growing, continuously hiring. Amazon, of course, is a staggering behemoth that hires people constantly, and as well as Microsoft. And Facebook has a new building that they have not too far from Amazon's campus as well. And so they're very highly engaged. I have a call with the Facebook recruiter on Thursday to talk a little bit about how Facebook and the program can work together. But hopefully we'll get a sponsorship from them next year. And we have really great relationships with all these companies already. So beyond that, even beyond the tech industry, right, there's lots of design studios. You can think about Fell Swoop, Tactile, Tectonic, Blink UX, Fjord all have offices here. I've talked to all of them recently, or all are interested in talking to our graduates and learning more about what the program can help them grow, especially in kind of solving smaller design problems or more completely. And it's just the weather is great. Don't believe the hype. The winter can be kind of bleak, but the summer is the best. There is no better. All right. So I'm going to turn it over to Matt. I'm going to give my voice a break for an hour or two. And Matt, who's our academic advisor, will tell you a little bit about where our students came from and where they went.